I want you to meet my fiance.
Another emerging talent brought a whole new level of violent realism to the screen. His name was Sam Peckinpah. He liked drinking, women, and brawling with studio executives. His violent lyricism would change movies forever.
First time I worked for Sam, he wrote The Rifleman. He hadn't directed at this point, but he came around the set and would whisper to me constantly, "Why don't you try this? Why don't you do this song?" So I was the guest star in The Rifleman, which sold, and he always got an income from. So that was when I first knew him. And he was one of the few guys that I knew in the inside that smoked grass. So he and I used to smoke in his office.
I knew Sam at the time of Wild Bunch, hanging around him. And wrote a long article about him, and I just thought he was brilliant. And I saw the 3 hour and 45 minute version of The Wild Bunch, which I thought was the most brilliant thing I'd ever fucking seen.
The Wild Bunch was, in part, an allegory for America's increasingly violent involvement in Vietnam. But fortunately, the violence of the new cinema, in Hollywood at least, had been limited to the screen. Meanwhile, Sam Peckinpah was continuing his politically incorrect ways. After scoring with the violent Wild Bunch, he had alienated women with the sexist Straw Dogs.
Sam was like a dog that you love, but he's always doing something that kind of embarrasses you, you know.
I don't even think Sam would be allowed to get into L.A., much less work in L.A. He was a total outlaw, and he was one of the last of a breed. He was like one of the Wild Bunch, you know.
But there was clearly a case of a real survivor. I mean, Sam had the mentality. He was like, he couldn't really create until he was face down in the bar room, dead broke, with everyone standing around laughing at him.
Dylan came to see me, and by that time we had cast Christofferson. He said, "You know, I got to tell you that in a past life I was Billy the Kid." So I said, "Well, that's great, you know, Bob. That's what you're in, you know." So 2 weeks later, we flew down to Durango together, and we went to see Sam. It was like late at night. Sam lived on kind of outside of town, and we walked up towards the house, and there was this scream out of the house, and this maid ran out just terrified, and we heard a shot. I thought, oh man, this is gonna blow the whole thing with Bob, you know.
Hey, Pete, who's that out there?
I knocked on Sam's door and there was no answer. I pushed open the door and Sam was standing in front of this mirror, completely naked with a gun in his hand. This mirror was totally blown to hell, and he was like looking at his reflection and didn't say anything. He had a bottle in one hand and a gun in the other, and I said, "Sam, this is Bob Dylan."
In the end, Dylan's soundtrack would make more money than Peckinpah's film.
He was trying to make something good. Unfortunately, it was so much creative energy I felt was expended in fighting the guys who were supposed to be on his side, you know, the studio or the producers or whatever.
As the alcoholic Peckinpah fought MGM over his director's cut, a rising star gave one of the boys from Malibu his first studio gig.
What happened to the directors like Peter, like Altman, like Peckinpah? These guys were doing whatever they wanted, and they were smoking dope, and they were drinking, and, you know, they lost their minds. See, I really think that's what happened, you know? It was the age of excess.
In the deserts of Nevada, Sam Peckinpah was driving convoy off the road.
Cocaine and booze was a big problem. And that would certainly explain a lot of the delays. I was on the wagon then, and Sam wasn't. And I would stay pretty much in my trailer. I didn't want to get out and get in trouble. And they actually fired him at one point. And I told him that I would walk if he weren't kept on the film. We were standing outside the saloon where the truck stop where the fight was. And he came up behind me and says, "You son of a bitch, I was out of here." And I said, well, you son of a bitch, you got me into here, you know? He was in rough shape.
Time and time again, he would ruin himself financially. He'd ruin his personal life. He'd ruin his reputation. And then, so he could do this whole Phoenix act. It didn't work with cocaine. He did fall flat down on the, face down on the floor again with cocaine, only this time he couldn't get up. It's a different drug, you know?
William Blake said the road of excess leads to the palace of wisdom. It also leads to the grave, you know?
Sam Peckinpah made one more picture, the compromised Osterman Weekend, before dying of heart failure at the age of 59 in Mexico. Most said he was the victim of his own excesses.
People can always say you're your own victim, but there are times that people have great talent, and that talent has to be nourished in some way, and if this industry can't nourish it, then they become victims, and then their self-indulgence sometimes takes over, and nobody pulls them up and pulls them out. I mean, if you write screenplay after screenplay after screenplay, or deal after deal after deal that you see fall apart and go away and so on, and you never lose your enthusiasm for wanting to make film, you're a victim. That's all.
Sam Peckinpah was addicted to anything that you could put into your any part of your body. I remember one time when I was editing for him, he literally, you know, to forget about walking a straight line, I was afraid that he wouldn't be able to get through doorways, you know, he had a little bit of leeway, and he would kind of like aim for it and just determinedly decide he was going to get through the doorway, and he would, you know, weave a little bit, but he would get through. And then I saw him get into his office, and his daughter called him. And you never saw a man get sober so quickly. Well, anyway, he was playing sober. He was acting sober, and he was speaking very slowly and carefully.
I did a picture with Sam Peckinpah, one of my favorites of all time. Bring me the head of Alfredo Garcia. What can I tell you? I had three meetings with him. He said the most wonderful things to me. He didn't mean one of them. He was a great con artist, a great salesman, a fabulous director. You know, you gave him the movie, he delivered the movie, the rest was bullshit, but it was so much fun. I mean, you know, and Alfredo Garcia is kind of a cult classic. We got a bunch of cult classics. Electric Glide and Blue, Bring Me the Fed of Alfredo Garcia. We did 200 Motels, you know, all those kind of stuff that we just took chances on people. And working with Peckinpah, I think I had three meetings with him, three lunches. You know, give me a break. He's going to do what he's going to do. And you have the privilege of having him con you for a while.
I don't think Sam ever understood really who Bob was or how good he was in that movie. I thought his music was one of the best parts of the film. And both Sam and his old music guy never really understood it. It was, I think Sam thought that the producers had brought Bob in to make it more commercial, you know, and he resented that. I think it was the first screening of a daily that Bob saw. We were watching the scene where Slim Pickens is dying with Katie Jurado, and it came back too dark, and you could barely see what was going on there. And Sam at one point got up and walked up and pissed on the screen. And Bob looked over at me like, who the hell are we working with here? These are maniacs, you know. But when I heard his song, Knocking on Heaven's Door, and it's getting dark, too dark to see, I thought, my God, he's working all the time. And the fact that it isn't in the director's cut just shows that Sam was still carrying old grudges, and he just didn't understand.
I don't think that director's cut. It's how far he got before they took the picture away.
Yeah, yeah. I think that Sam, as I remember, in any of the talking that I had with him after was that he came to appreciate it, you know. At the time, Sam was in pretty rough shape. The last time I saw Sam, when he was living on a trailer out there, Paradise Park or wherever in Malibu, we talked about that stuff in there, and in my opinion, it was the best, you know, one of the best parts of the film. And I remember him agreeing with me.